Recorded Books presents Trust Agents, using the web to build influence, improve reputation, and earn trust. 10th Anniversary Edition by Chris Brogan and Julien Smith. Narrated by the authors. That's me. To the people who've brought these ideas to life over the last 10 years and counting. Chris Brogan. To my parents who showed me the way. Julien Smith. Acknowledgements. Thanks to Shannon, Queen of All Things Book Vargo, Matt, Dive Bar Finder Holt, Ellen, Why Don't You Have a Book Deal Gerstein, and Chris, This Won't Hurt a Bit Webb, from John Wiley & Sons. Thanks also to Jeff Believe in Yourself Pulver and countless others who believed. Introduction. The year 2020 feels like the future. There are video games and sci-fi movies and songs and comic books that all talk this year as if it's some very far-off event. But now we're here. Look how. On this day, Julien had a jar of kimchi explode in his kitchen. Chris still has some laundry to get done. We're writing this while communicating over Google Meet, which used to be Google Hangouts, which used to be part of Google Plus, a social network that came and went since we last updated this book, as have many others. Did we know any of this specifically would happen? Of course not. But a lot of what you'll see in this book, surprising amounts even to us, we did and went even further than we could have anticipated. The future is faster and more chaotic than we could have predicted, even though Trust Agents came out back in 2009. Technically, it's a bit more than 10 years ago, but not yet 11. So let's talk about the future. We had lots of predictions, hunches, and ideas. Sift through what we said way back in 2009, and before that on our blogs, to see that we were living in a time where we felt it was more than possible that companies would adopt social media and social networking tools to build better relationships with customers and other stakeholders. We were right. That's kind of cool to see. Companies did, as we stated, hire more and more people to interact with people via social networks and the digital web. Friends like Ryan Boyles over at IBM and Sandy Carter at Amazon are even more prevalent than the days when we first wrote this book. We never would have guessed that social networks would be used to challenge governments and regimes in events such as Arab Spring and the Hong Kong protests and beyond. We could never have seen that they would become among the most powerful and influential businesses in the world globally. We had no idea that Mark Zuckerberg would have to testify before Congress, "Senator, we run ads," and would become the new old Bill Gates. We had no idea that Jeff Bezos would buy the Washington Post, or that the New York Times would reverse its descent from print, soon to be making $800 million a year in digital revenue. We didn't know how powerful Twitter would become to influence people's ideas, despite being a business 20 times smaller than Facebook. We couldn't sense that Spotify, Apple, and streaming would become the main way people consume audio content, including through Shopify's acquisition of Anchor, podcasts. We didn't know that Joe Rogan or anyone would become as big as they are strictly from podcasting. None of this was knowable, but surprisingly, even to us in 2009, it was implied by the direction that year was going. Look more, and you'll see that we grossly overstated the future benefit of blogs. Julien doesn't blog any longer. He wrote 3 books, 2 with Chris, and then he started Breather.com, a flexible office space business that raised $150 million, and he grew it into a thriving and still scrappy multinational. Chris blogs infrequently. It turns out that podcasts and video channels are a lot more popular than when we wrote this. And while we still don't recommend it, people take to sites like Facebook and LinkedIn, now very much more a media site, and Medium to write their posts and voice their ideas. The world is going flat and non-hierarchical, while at the same time being even more unequal than it's ever been. One voice is even more powerful in 2020 than it ever was in 2009. But is it a real voice? You probably won't be surprised if we tell you that. If you went to thispersondoesnotexist.com, you can view a completely convincing portrait of what is not at all a human, but instead a computer-generated unique facsimile. Once you leave the site, that face ceases to exist and will never appear again. So was that a real person? No. But it sure did look like one, and it sure could convince the everyday internet citizen. That's trust today. Is that scary? It is, right? Of course. But at the same time, scary and normal have occasionally become the same thing. It's sort of like a William Gibson novel. Yet every day, we humans grapple with the new, adapt to it, and find ways to make it work for us and make business around it. That ultimately is what Trust Agents was about, although we didn't know it that well then. Technology is a medium, and the social web at that time was a nascent one, growing and fragile. Now it's dominant. But trust is even more powerful online and even easier to leverage to create powerful business opportunities than it was in 2020. Thus, although some technology has changed, humans mostly have not. So let's talk about them and how to be human, both vulnerable and powerful online, and what it can do for you. Chapter 1. Trust, Social Capital, and Media. The Connected Guy. Joe Pistone thought he was going to go undercover for 6 months. Instead, he vanished for 6 years. He was already practically a wise guy. He'd grown up in among the mafia in Paterson, New Jersey, and worked the same kinds of jobs as they did. Like many involved with the mob, Pistone was of Sicilian descent and spoke Italian. When he started showing up at Carmelo's, a restaurant at 1638 York Avenue on the corner of 86th Street and one block from the East River, he fit in perfectly. He knew it was a spot in Manhattan where wise guys hung out, and he knew he'd get acquainted eventually. He just didn't know how deep he would get. Turns out that, to go undercover, Pistone knew how to make all the right moves. He knew that in order to be a good undercover agent, he needed to be a good street agent, someone who understood not just how things worked in an office, but out in the city too. He knew all about the mob from growing up around its members, but he had been brought up by a family whose values led him to join the FBI. But the FBI didn't know who he was anymore. No one named Joe Pistone was working for them anymore, nor was there anyone in the company records by that name. His personnel file had been removed, and his desk had been entirely cleaned out. As Pistone himself says of his old life, "I obliterated it." While Pistone was immersing himself in mob life, the FBI was trying to figure out who this new guy with the Bonanno family was. Pistone had remade himself into a jewel thief named Donnie Brasco. As it turns out, Pistone was so deep that even FBI surveillance teams who were following him had no idea who they were taking pictures of. The name Donnie Brasco was suddenly everywhere. But the FBI didn't know where he'd come from. Most wise guys had grown up in or near the city. But Brasco's story was that he was from California, and he'd spent time in Florida doing some jobs, i.e. burglaries, before his arrival in New York City. When Pistone was officially brought into the mob, it was by Benjamin Lefty Guns Ruggiero. That day, he became a connected guy, someone connected to the mob, but not officially a made guy or wise guy, which is an official member of the Cosa Nostra. But you don't just get connected to the mob that easily. Pistone had spent more than 6 months working undercover in New York, becoming a regular at Carmelo's before he could gain Ruggiero's trust. It was this patience, this diligence, that helped him move quickly up the ranks. His first moves, though, were subtle ones. At Carmelo's, he would occasionally see mobsters the FBI wanted more information about, but as he said, "I never got an opportunity to get into conversation with them. It isn't wise to say to the bartender, 'Who's that over there? Isn't that so-and-so?'" Pistone wanted to be known as a guy who didn't ask too many questions, didn't appear too curious. With the guys we were after, it was tough to break in. A wrong move, even if you're just on the fringes of things, will turn them off. Instead, Donnie Brasco learned to play backgammon, a game wise guys played a lot around then, and just hung out. Around Christmas, he was able to get into a couple of games with the right people. He introduced himself as Don, and let people see him hanging around so that they would recognize him as a regular at the bar. Now he could sit around and chat with the others. "What do you do?" asked Marty, the bartender, eventually. Marty wasn't a mob guy, but he knew that many of his clientele were mobsters. That sort of question wasn't the kind you answered directly, claims Pistone. So he said, oh, you know, not doing anything right now, you know, hanging out, looking around. Basically, I do anything where I can make a fast buck. He made clear what kind of a guy Donnie Brasco was, and word got around. In Pistone's own words, the important thing here in the beginning was not so much to get hooked up with anybody in particular and get action going right away. The important thing was to have a hangout, a good backup for credibility. When I went other places, I could say, I've been hanging out at that place for 4 or 5 months, and they could check it out. The guys that have been hanging around in this place would say, yeah, Don Brasco has been coming in here for quite a while, and he seems all right, never tried to pull anything on us. That's the way you build up who you are, little by little, never moving too fast, never taking too big a bite at one time. There are occasions when you suddenly have to take a big step or a big chance. Those come later. Finally, the time was right for Pistone to make a move. He brought some jewelry from the FBI that had been confiscated during investigations to the bar with the intention of selling it to the mobsters. Since cops are always trying to buy illegal items to make a bust, Pistone decided he would make Brasco do something different. Because he'd already made clear to anyone who asked that Brasco wasn't on the up and up, he could try to sell a couple of diamond rings, a couple of loose stones, and a couple of men's and ladies' wristwatches to the bartender. Pistone recounts the story. If you'd like to hold on to these for a couple of days, I said, you could try and get rid of them. What's the deal? He asked. I need $2,500 total. Anything over that is yours. And so it began. At Carmelo's, he met Albert, who was connected to the Colombo family. From there, he hooked up with Jilly's crew, who stole all sorts of goods around New York and sold it in a place called Acerg, backwards for Jilly's last name, Greca. From there, he connected with Tony Mira, a soldier from the Bonanno family. Mira was a knife man, and Brasco was told if you ever get into an argument with him, make sure you stay an arm's length away because he will stick you. Pistone stayed in the mafia for 6 years. He was so deeply immersed in that life that at one point, he was one kill away from being made, turned into a real mobster. He claims that the whole time he never lost his moral compass, never doubted himself or strayed from his mission. Today, Pistone lives under an assumed name somewhere in the United States with his family. He brought the mafia to its knees. Every individual the FBI would go after during this time, it would get, all because of Pistone. The best infiltrator ever to have entered the mob, La Cosa Nostra never truly recovered. There's a lot we could learn from Pistone's efforts. But first, we'd like to introduce you to another imposter of a wholly different variety, Alan Conway. Stanley Kubrick. Who was Alan Conway? Videos display him as an older British gentleman, effete and smug, with a sparkle in his eye and gray hair. But Conway is in fact much more than that. He's a small-time British con artist who became famous for impersonating Stanley Kubrick in the early 1990s. It was an act that he kept up despite many challenges, namely that he looked nothing like Kubrick. The famous director had dark, deep-set eyes, was famous for his thick beard, was of a different nationality, and had a different accent than Conway. In addition, Conway barely knew anything about the famous film director's movies. Despite this, Conway conned many, many people. One victim was well-known New York Times columnist Frank Rich, who was in London in 1993, and with three other journalists met Conway at a club. Although Rich had met Stanley Kubrick before, it didn't prevent him from being duped. "Oh, I shaved my beard off," Conway told him. Rich wrote about his meeting with the Kubrick imposter in the Times shortly thereafter. He said of the incident, "On our euphoric way out, we quizzed the manager of the club, who knew only one member of the group Conway was with, a white-haired man who said he was a conservative member of British Parliament." That should have been the tip-off, a friend at the Associated Press told me when commiserating 2 days later. They're always surrounded by con men and rent boys. By then, an executive at Warner Brothers who had been reached by phone had expressed his delight at the news that a table full of journalists had been duped. He also told us that Kubrick's new film was no secret, but was in fact a well-publicized adaptation of a novel by someone I know. Kubrick's assistant called to add that the director was neither beardless nor gay, but was concerned about the imposter, who had been cited 15 to 20 times over the past 2 to 3 years. Despite his concern, Kubrick was also fascinated by the idea of an imposter. But the director of Dr. Strangelove and 2001 A Space Odyssey was a recluse. And that is what gave Conway his strength. Kubrick had become a kind of spirit whose name he could evoke to cause others to lose control over their senses. Thinking that they were faced with the opportunity of a lifetime, Conway's victims wanted so badly to believe the ruse that all the contradictory evidence meant nothing to them. Conway was able to get away with anything. Under Kubrick's name, he co-signed a loan for a gay club in Soho, for example, and was long gone by the time his victims knew what was going on. Worse, no one wanted to testify against him because they would expose themselves as having been duped by a con man. They would be ridiculed, they reasoned, and so all declined. Conway continued his Stanley Kubrick impersonations for many years. Eventually he dropped it and later joined Alcoholics Anonymous. Yet even there, he told everyone another whole set of tall tales involving businesses in the Cayman Islands and an otherwise exciting life recounted in a diary form after his death in 1998. But by then, the world was being transformed. The internet was expanding in full force, and Google had just been founded, changing the way we would all interact and whom we would trust forever. Why is this important? While most people haven't heard of Joe Pistone, they do recognize the name Donnie Brasco, because he was portrayed by Johnny Depp in the 1997 film of the same name. Likewise, most people haven't heard of Alan Conway, but they do know of Stanley Kubrick, or at least his famous films like A Clockwork Orange or The Shining. This book is about trust, but it's also about how technology can influence it. This book is about the crossroads between the two and how it impacts your business. Pistone and Conway were able to deceive everyone they met because back then, you couldn't just type Stanley Kubrick into Google Images and find a picture of him. Conway delighted in the fact that finding information about Kubrick involved hours of vigorous research, something that few were really willing to do. Today, Pistone might have had a Facebook or a Twitter profile page before going undercover, or at the very least, would have shown up in an archive in his professional profile on LinkedIn. Once your traces are on the web, they're there forever, as is your reputation. We sit at a unique time. Technology overlays everything in life and business. The number of people with a smartphone in every developed country in the world is 67% and rising. When we first wrote this book, words like Twitter and podcast were still relatively foreign, and companies like Snapchat were unknown. Today, tweets are in every single daily newscast and sports story as a way to accept and share people's ideas. One's online identity is a given in a way that it is not when this book was first written. In the Donnie Brasco example, trust could only be earned face-to-face. In this modern world, massive world-shifting events are happening because of an app that lets you type 280 characters. Heck, even that's changed since the first publication in 2009, when Twitter only allowed 140 characters. Donnie Brasco could do a lot more studying before even walking into that bar, such as it were. A great website makes us trust you. Having a podcast makes us think that you've got something worth saying, even if everyone seems to have a podcast in 2020. Yet there's an irony that's far too painful to consider, which we can't spare you from. What is the truth anyway? The way people use the web is constantly changing. People have become warier of where the information they receive comes from, and with good reason. We read articles about how the person beside us at the bar ordering the Miller Genuine Draft is actually trying to create buzz for an underground viral marketing campaign. We read product reviews on websites believing that they're a reflection of what the reviewers think of the product, only to find out that products returning a higher cut of the profits are always rated higher than products that may be superior in quality. We know how less than honest advertisers and marketers work to influence us. We realize that those few lazy reporters in our media who just report on whatever a PR firm tells them without follow-up offer poor reporting. We are living in an age where the economic collapse of 2008 and 2009 shook our trust in our entire financial system, and where fake news is a phrase almost as common as social media, compromising the viability of our retirement funds and our trust in the things that we read and see, sending massive waves of distrust through billions of people on the globe. When the COVID-19 pandemic started in 2020, dangerous misinformation spread like wildfire. Reports of preventative cures were rampant, several involving potentially toxic ingredients. Bad advice spread quickly by word of mouth, sometimes innocently, and sometimes with potential malice. In an age in which technologies such as Google prevail over almost all information, it's unclear whether either of the two gentlemen discussed earlier would have been able to pass as the people they impersonated for so long. Conway's elaborate Stanley Kubrick impersonation was eventually discovered as a fraud and exposed on television in a series called The Lying Game. By that time, he'd already borrowed tens of thousands of dollars from people who believed he was the real thing. As for Joe Pistone, his true identity was never exposed. That is to say, until the FBI revealed it. This enabled him to send more than 100 members of the New York mob to prison. How would he have done this in the 21st century with much of our communication going through digital channels? Obliterating an identity online, as well as in the real world, is extremely difficult. It's easier than ever to reach out and do business with people using the web, but harder than ever to get them to trust you. This is especially true in an environment where the relationship is new and where the prospective customer has access to far more information about your organization, products, and services than ever before. We could never have predicted fake news. Just Google the term post-truth and it'll make you sad. In 2020, we live in a world where people see something posted on Facebook and accept it as true. Reports of Russian tampering with the 2016 U.S. presidential election were confirmed, and worse, that continues to this day. Nearly daily, a new report arrives showing how Facebook or some other site is trying to combat the endless stream of misinformation being published as fact. When we wrote this book, the biggest fear was that maybe your grandmother would click a link and crash your computer, or that maybe your uncle would send money to a Nigerian prince. Those guys have all the money. But this is far worse. Look also at deep fakes. Technology exists, and we're talking desktop app level ease of use stuff, that will allow anyone to make convincing video footage of someone saying or doing something that never happened. You can't even trust your own eyes. Julien and Chris talked about what to say in this section. The problem is that this could be an entire book on its own, and other people have written books about the online misinformation phenomenon. You don't need our take. Fake news is bad. That's easy enough. But there's one way the social web and all our various tools have made fake news a little harder to pull off. We can look for more sources. We can look for people who aren't us and don't share our views for different perspectives. We can seek ways to decide for ourselves. What's changed is that you can't really take anything at face value in 2020 and beyond unless it comes from someone you trust enough to watch your kids or your dogs. Humanizing the web. Although the general public's level of mistrust is at an all-time high, there are individuals and companies who do successfully use the internet and social media to establish levels of trust in the communities where they operate. 10 years ago, we first wrote about this in the first edition of Trust Agents. Today, we're here to update that book and to talk to you about how social media and the web are used in a modern communications environment. Now, with Facebook as one of the world's dominant, most powerful companies, and where social media is interconnected with geopolitics and news, and sometimes impossible to distinguish one from another. When we wrote Trust Agents back in 2009, Twitter was only a few years old. We were telling companies that it really could turn into something. When was the last time you saw a mainstream news show or sports show that didn't reference someone's tweets? World news is coming in at 280 characters at a time. Those who are most familiar with the digital space, we refer to them as digital natives, have become accustomed to a new level of transparency. They have always operated under the assumption that everything they do will eventually be known online. Realizing that they're unable to hide anything, they choose not to try. At once, a new generation is building its own version of digital identity with different personas for different services, sometimes deleting accounts over and over again to remain invisible. But both types leverage the web to meet their goals, using identity and a still nascent form of powerful media presence to affect their lives, whether it be by producing relationships for work or tightening the circles they want to share with. The world has changed, and it's not going back. But listen, and this is very important, this isn't about age. When the whole social media thing landed in 2006 or so, most companies looked around for a nephew or a niece or the kid in some part of the company who knew computers, and that was okay for about a year and a half. If for some odd reason you think you still don't have to understand these tools, the rest of your professional working life will be rather unpleasant, insofar as you'll have to operate through the agency of others. Instead of sharing your voice and ideas and seeking fellowship on your own, you'll be relegated to asking a kid to convey the breadth of values and vision you want to communicate on behalf of your organization or yourself. This world is the world. Digital isn't some other thing. It's one way to interact with the world at large. Transparency. You probably know what we're about to tell you, but it's possible you've never much thought about it. For every photo that a magazine uses as part of an article, there are perhaps another 60 that won't be used. For every quote a journalist pulls from a source for a story, there are several minutes of conversation that aren't used. This is simply editing, a part of storytelling, except for when it isn't. What if there are times when we want every possible angle, every possible description, every version of the story that we can get our hands on? What if what was left on the cutting room floor is of real value to the public? Think about moments of world-impacting news, or even moments within your company where a rumor leaks into the mainstream. It's in those missed moments, the forgotten photos, the deleted details, that tell the true story. We're in a new era of increasing transparency, and it's becoming obvious from a number of angles that the world will never be the same because of it. Information flows faster, and it's everywhere. Human memory is slowly becoming obsolete as you get access to everything you ever need to know through your Google Home. We barely need to remember everyone's name when all their information is everywhere. It's all in public view. Clay Shirky examined this phenomenon in his book, Here Comes Everybody, in which he explains how the barriers that have prevented like-minded individuals from coming together are disappearing, allowing us all to transmit our thoughts and get information faster than we ever could before. Because of this, secrets are impossible to keep for long. First, digital photography made everyone look like a supermodel online. It's easy to look great when you choose the best out of 100 photos. Check out Reddit's /r/Instagram reality community for a glimpse at this. But then something else happened. People gained the ability to upload their own pictures, the ability to tag themselves, affix information about themselves to other people's pictures, and to remove the tags they didn't like. The next thing you know, all those terrible pictures of you, including those unflattering ones a photographer would have selectively edited and deleted, are all over the web, impossible to remove. We've seen this over and over. Someone famous says something racist, a company makes a tasteless tweet, one quick bad moment captured on video becomes the instant downfall of someone. Your past is forever on the web for people born after 1998 or so, and your recent past can still bite you even if you're older. Those who are active on the web now realize that they need to embrace this new transparency and that all things will now eventually be known. Companies can no longer hide behind a veneer of a shiny branding campaign because customers are just one Google search away from the truth. So instead, companies work hard to appear human on Twitter and YouTube, showing off their brand's personality for all to see. All the while, the audiences become more and more cynical, aware of everyone's potential motives, questioning everything they read and see. Companies must acknowledge that they are more naked on the web than ever, just as individuals are. This shouldn't be a surprise. Any new medium you jump into changes the way you're seen. But since the web is active 24/7 and has cameras on all angles with everyone having their own version of the story, it's difficult for anyone to hide for long. In 2009, when Trust Agents was first released, we proposed a different solution. But first, we need to equip you with some tools. How trust is modified by media. Imagine that the radio had been invented yesterday. Suddenly, you and everyone you know hears about this machine, and one day, you actually see one at a local diner. Picture it. For the first time, you're hearing music coming out of a machine instead of being played live right before you. Or perhaps if you couldn't afford to see a band play live, you were able to hear music for the first time. What now? Imagine yourself in this moment. Immediately, it's obvious that something incredible is happening. If you're open to new ideas, you may realize how amazing it is. Now imagine that following this song, we imagine a really jazzy Benny Goodman number, you hear a news broadcast. Think about it. What happens? You're hearing a human voice right next to you, as if it's speaking directly to you. Some questions would pop up. Who is this person? Are they trustworthy? How true is this information? The answers would have a lot to do with the information being broadcast, as well as the sincerity and timbre of the person's voice. A variety of factors come into play, all of which will cause you to wonder what's going on. If you need something concrete, consider two extreme examples of this. Imagine the Hindenburg disaster. Oh, the humanity! And then think about the famous War of the Worlds broadcast directed by Orson Welles. How would you react? Whether you imagine yourself to trust what you are hearing or not, one thing remains true. The medium has transformed the message. An official-sounding voice might make you confident that what you're hearing is true. Another voice might give you the impression that it's a radio drama. Fiction being performed for you through the technology in this new box. This book is about all the new radios being invented in our day, from the common ones like web pages, email, or instant messaging, to the newest, YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and the others. In our radio example, someone had to take control to get that broadcast to you. Likewise, there are people out there right now working to understand these new technologies and learning everything about how to use them, from etiquette to audience building and beyond. They're learning the ropes. They are the pioneers mastering the latest one-to-many communications methods. Like your kids, they know more about technology and maybe even more about people than you do. And that makes them very powerful. In 2009, we called them trust agents. Today, we're here to show you why this is more relevant than ever before. Why trust agents, and why now? Where we spend our time daily has changed dramatically. According to Mary Meeker's 2019 Internet Trends Report, people spend an average of 6.3 hours per day online. 3.6 of those hours are on mobile devices. Mobile devices have now surpassed television as the device most used for information gathering, and 28% of all video watched is digital and growing. Where are they all? By the time we publish this, half the places we mention will be dead. At the same time, this is the era of fake news. Fewer people than ever before can easily discern between a credible news source and fabricated news. We need trust agents in companies. In fact, businesses cannot exist without them anymore. We need real-world trust agents to help us understand what we can believe and what should not be believed. Everything is different. It's a whole new world. We are currently living in a communications environment where there is a constant trust deficit. As a society, we no longer have confidence in advertising. We're hostile to those who appear to have ulterior motives, even if they're just selling themselves. The result is our tendency to join together into loose networks or tribes that gather based on common interests. We tend to be suspicious of anything that comes to us from outside our circle of friends. So we form groups of like-minded individuals around those topics, products, or news items that interest us. For example, Reddit reports news differently than the London Times or the Wall Street Journal. And that news might be suspect in certain circles, because the stories on Reddit that reach the top are sometimes moved to the top by dubious means. Voting campaigns, robotic algorithms, and so forth. Again, we ask you, who should you trust? Trust agents have established themselves as being non-exclusively sales-oriented, non-high-pressure marketers. Instead, they're digital natives using the web to be genuine and to humanize their business. They build brand. They're interested in people, prospective customers, employees, colleagues, and others. And they've realized that these tools that enable more unique, robust communication and allow more business opportunities for everyone. And today, they are indispensable. What exactly are trust agents? They are the power users of the web, educated more by way of their own experiences and experiments than from the core of their professional work. They speak new online technologies fluently. They learn by trying, so they're bold in their efforts to try out new applications and devices. They're not afraid to fail. They connect with more people than anyone else, and they know how to leave a good impression. As they do so, they build healthy, honest relationships. Trust agents use today's web tools to spread their influence faster, wider, and deeper than a typical company's PR or marketing department might be capable of achieving, and with more genuine interest in people, too. We need to become them and to harness them. As we delve more deeply into this topic, we intend for you to consider two things. One, how to be genuine, real, and open with people, while also, two, recognizing that if you can think strategically and understand certain principles, you can learn how to master tomorrow's radios as well as trust agents do. You can bring the news to people. You can build influence, share influence, and benefit from the other currencies that such exchanges of trust deliver to you. Most people will do this within a business setting while working for a company, but always with an eye towards being legitimate and honest with the community within which they operate. The more you read, the more you'll realize that we're asking you to balance being genuinely part of an online community with being aware of business opportunities and how executing the trust agent strategy can help you realize business goals. We know that this can be tricky business, but also that it's absolutely possible. Further, we believe you can do it too. A trust agent's version of a resume or CV. We know that you hate your resume. Hey, we hate resumes too. They don't really represent us. They diminish our skills and they fail to capture the complexity of our experiences. For almost every job that we've held in the past 3 years, neither of us has had to present a resume ever. We want you to get the job you want without a resume. This book will teach you how. As you build up social capital and reputation, don't forget to create a spectacular about page on your website. Weigh it heavily towards what others might hire you to do or how they might partner with you. Remember that this counts internally as well. The web is such a powerful resource for leveraging contacts and presenting our strengths that a CV becomes irrelevant. It's not so much that you won't need one, but that you'll never be asked for a CV because your reputation will precede you. Instead, you'll just get hired. Read on. The Matrix Thing. When discussing the core concepts of trust agents, we find ourselves thinking a lot about the concepts of the movie The Matrix, the first one, not the sequels. If you've seen it, you know that Morpheus shows Neo that the life he's lived up until that point was all a big program. Neo learns that if he could figure out the program and navigate the space outside of the world, then he could figure out and own the Matrix, which is to say, ignore what everybody else sees as rules or laws. Well, that's kind of what we're talking about. There's a lot of similarity in realizing the inherent game-like structure of online interactions, and there are some similar and some different methods in which we choose to interact with these experiences. We believe in the value of people and in being genuine with them. At the same time, we also realize that people frequently act within the context of these structures, and that if we want to find a way to success, it often involves breaking our connection to that structure. There are two ways to proceed with doing business. One is to work completely within the system and to operate by the natural rules that exist. The other is to realize its structure, understand the rules that dictate the functions of the system, and to then choose whether to work strictly within it or not, or even to move between different systems that might get you to a goal better, sooner, faster, cheaper, etc. In researching this book and organizing our thoughts on how we interact with people on the web, we realized that there's a big difference between those who play strictly within a system and those who work outside it. We tend towards the latter, and you can too. but we'll explain more about that later. Beyond that, you don't really have to know much about the Matrix to enjoy the rest of the book. We promise. Media and what they do. We all know what the word media means, but in his 1964 book, Understanding Media, The Extensions of Man, from which comes the famous slogan, "The medium is the message," Marshall McLuhan describes a medium as any extension of the human body. We like to think of media in the same way. By basing our ideas of what a medium is on McLuhan's definition, we come to see that wheels are a medium because they're an extension of our feet, and that money is a medium that extends human power. It follows that we view online social networks, the Facebooks and Twitters of our time, as media, not because they help us communicate, but because they extend human relationships. This is something that neither television nor radio ever could have done because they're one-way entities. Email never did it as effectively either because the communication didn't occur in a public space. Now, with the advent of blogs, our communications can reach everyone, and thus we can connect with everyone because they can respond to us directly. There's a big difference in the way traditional print, radio, and television media was used from the 1950s until the present. Newspapers, magazines, television, and radio were all different ways to interrupt people, grab their attention, and shove a message into their thought processes. In the case of television, and during the heyday of print advertising, something interesting was happening. The mix of it being a novelty, not everyone had a TV, so conversations were often about every detail and nuance of the experience, and being persuasive, before we had tools to counter any of the claims. A few scant years earlier, the radio drama War of the Worlds was mistaken as being a true news report of an alien invasion. This had changed over the past number of years, and even more powerfully in the past two decades. Somewhere along the line, institutions took ownership of certain media. Newspapers won't print just anything you send to them. Televisions won't play the video you made, and radio doesn't always play the songs you want or read the news you feel is important. Over the past year, all of these systems have met with competition from an entirely unexpected source, you. You can print anything you want on your blog. You can post any video you want on YouTube, Facebook, or TikTok, or several other services. You can make your own music and share it. You can podcast whatever appeals to you. Because of this, McLuhan's vision of media as an extension of ourselves is truer than ever. We've chosen to make the next media ours, and we've shaped our own media to be an extension of our own views, our own businesses, and our tribes. We see now why this is an important time and why the communicators of today need a new title, that of trust agent. Why trust agents? Having learned about the rainbow while we were growing up, almost any of us could easily recite its spectrum of colors without a problem. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet. But were you aware that at least one of these, orange, a color we take for granted, did not always exist? In fact, its first official use was recorded in the court of Henry VIII. No one used the term before the actual fruit, the orange, arrived from China in the 10th century. We call people redheads, and we use the term goldfish because orange didn't exist back then. New terms, in fact, are invented all the time and thus shouldn't really surprise anyone. Podcast, a word that describes audio you subscribe to over the internet, became the Oxford American Dictionary's Word of the Year in 2004 and is now so common that many of us on the web don't think twice before using it. Likewise, trolling. The act of anonymously annoying the hell out of people over the internet is another recently coined term. There's a vernacular here that is at once as common to people online and foreign to those from other cultures, similar to the esoteric language used by Harley riders, Manchester United football fans, or wine enthusiasts. Trust agent isn't the kind of thing you would call yourself. That's like people calling themselves gurus, divas, goddesses, or experts. Let other people call you that. We prefer to say trust agent moves and point out people who act as trust agents. For example, we might say Alex Chris is the GM of QuickBooks and I can always reach out and ask him a question directly. he definitely makes trust agent moves for QuickBooks. In another sense, trust agent can be a kind of unofficial job title. Some of these people have roles like community manager, or they may be in the online facing part of public relations. The name isn't synonymous with either title. First, communities don't want to be managed. They want to be cared for. Second, public relations departments fill people's inboxes with dozens of cold pitches every day. We've even received offers for free sneakers by email in exchange for posting to our audience. That said, we promise we're not here to trash PR professionals, at least not the good ones. You'll get a feel for who trust agents are, and you'll learn what being one entails. People who humanize a company or organization on a digital platform like the web or a podcast or a YouTube channel are trust agents. People who understand the systems and how to make their own game are trust agents. People who connect and build fluid relationships are trust agents. By the end of this book, you'll probably be a trust agent too. Just don't call yourself one. The basics, social capital. In October of 2002, after the largest study on humor ever conducted, scientists discovered what they believed to be the funniest joke of all time. Conducted over the web, the study collected more than 40,000 jokes and attracted almost 2 million ratings. This was the winning joke. Two hunters are out in the woods when one of them collapses. He doesn't seem to be breathing and his eyes are glazed. The other guy whips out his phone and calls 911. He gasps, "My friend is dead. What can I do?" The operator says, "Calm down. I can help. First, let's make sure he's dead." There's a silence and then a shot is heard. Back on the phone, the guy says, "Okay, now what?" The beauty of a joke and information of many varieties is that it can be infinitely reused without losing any of its value. But there's more at work here. You may not have realized what just happened, so we'd like to play it back to you in slow motion, step by step. First, we decided to include a joke at the beginning of this section. We didn't invent it. In fact, it was submitted by psychiatrist Gurpal Gosal from Manchester, United Kingdom, to the aforementioned study. What happens then? Well, you heard the joke, and if we did our job right, you laughed. However, it's what happens afterwards that's interesting. But before we explain that, consider the next example. Chris has an apple and Julian has a dollar. Let's say that Julian wants an apple and that Chris would rather have a dollar than a piece of fruit, so they decide to trade. Simple, right? At the beginning of the story, Chris had an apple and now he has a dollar. We can actually continue to follow this dollar on its journey, if we like, being traded for apples the world over. But the point is made, that is, dollars don't just grow on trees. They don't simply replicate themselves by being passed around. They're exchanged for goods, and that's it. What about our joke? Let's say you take our joke and tell your friend. What happens? Hopefully he or she laughs, and then you both have the joke. It isn't gone. Both you and your friend have it. When we follow the joke along its path, though, something remarkable happens. Everyone is left just a little bit richer. Not only did they laugh, but now they can tell the joke as well. Our joke is an example of social capital. Capital is usually defined as any form of wealth capable of being employed in the production of more wealth. Our joke has value. It's hard to nail down exactly what the value is, but it's clearly there. Therefore, it's a form of wealth, just as in our definition. But our joke isn't regular capital. You can't put it in a savings account, and you can't usually trade it for an apple. So what is it? In this way, social capital is different from other kinds of capital. When people come together and share a meal, they not only end up fed, they also become tighter as a group. The mere act of gathering means that they will exchange things, stories, favors, and laughs, and will grow richer as a result. It may sound touchy-feely, but these things have real value. And we don't just mean that they keep you warm on a cold night either. We mean they have real value, as in you can take it to the bank value. But how? It's simple. Jokes aren't the only form of social capital. Favors are too. Buying somebody a cup of coffee is a real exchange of value, and it can at some point be repaid. You can never truly be sure how, but the fact that it can be repaid is unquestionable. You can ask for that cup of coffee back one day. Just think of your favorite television cop drama and how often the phrase, "You owe me one," is uttered. These things are real. We've already made clear that social capital has real value. If you find someone a job, then that person may find a job for you when you really need one. The real magic, the core of our argument, is what happens on the web. Because the web is made out of text, everything on the web is written down. And once it's out there, thanks to Google, it'll always be out there. This brings us to something we call putting it on paper, and it will change the way you think of our basic joke forever. Put it on paper. What happens when we put our joke on our website or on our blog? At first glance, it shouldn't be much different than telling friends. But in fact, it's extremely different. It's much more powerful and long-lasting, and the reasons may surprise you. Publishing our joke to a recent blog post may allow it to be seen by only a dozen visitors, or it may be seen by hundreds. In that way, this isn't very different than telling the joke in a bar, or maybe getting on stage and doing stand-up at an open mic night. The difference between putting it on the web, or in a book for that matter, is that when the joke is being told on the internet, the joke teller is no longer there. The joke teller is gone. Yes, the joke is still being told, and yes, the teller is still getting credit for it. He or she is still participating, but that participation is no longer active. The same is true of YouTube. When the famous Evolution of Dance video was first posted on YouTube, by our count in April of 2006, the video's originator, Judson Lapley, may have been present to upload it. Obviously, he was also there when he performed it. But after it went viral, eventually reaching a view count of more than 306 million views at the time of this writing, Judson Lapley was not there. He may have been having lunch, going on a date, doing another stand-up act, or even sleeping. But his
presence. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.